Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this master class on CARETOR, Customs Administration of Rules of Origin under Trade Agreements and Faceless Assessments under Customs. I think you all would agree that 2020, this year, in terms of reforms of under custom, has been really important. So CARETOR and Faceless Assessment under Customs, this has definitely, you know, impacted a lot of taxpayers, and we are very happy to conduct this masterclass today on these two important reforms under customs. And without any delay, we would be starting the session. Before that, I would introduce Mr. Shashi Bhushan Singh. So, sir, we are very fortunate to have him as advisor to FICCI. Currently, he is advisor to FICCI, and he was special secretary to Government of India and member of Central Board of Excise and Customs. Sir, during his tenure, he has decades of experience with customs, central excise, and he has been part of various reforms while his tenure with CBIC, and he has played a important role in rationalizing various indirect tax laws and procedure to achieve the objective of ease of doing business. He also handled the process at CBIC connected with the passage of 122nd Constitutional Amendment Bill. Then he was also given he also supervised the work related to drafting of GST laws and processes. Sir was also director in the board of GSTN, and even during his tenure as chief commissioner, he was appointed by the government in the exercise of revenue neutral rate and point of supply. We are very fortunate to have you, sir, in our masterclass today. That's very kind of you to agree for this masterclass, and we are looking forward to have your perspective, because sir, you have worked with the government for a number of years. You have been part of a lot of reforms, so we look forward to your perspective on CARETOR and faceless assessment under customs. Before our expert speakers, I'll be introducing our expert speaker after we have valuable insights from sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ira. Good afternoon to everyone, my colleagues from PwC and all the participants. As far as CARETOR, details of CARETOR and faceless assessment is concerned, the team of PwC will be making the presentation in detail and telling you the nitty-gritties. I will only touch down from my perspective, why was the need for CARETOR? Before that, we have to cover a little bit about the free trade agreements. Recent RCEP signing was quite in the news, where India refused to be a part to be a signatory. And in fact, trade agreements have always been there, and they are the integral parts of country-state policy. After Second World War, General Agreement on Tariff and Trade is a guiding document for finalizing trade deals. Article 24 therein lays down the legal framework for trade agreements between the members, which are basically providing tariff and non-tariff concession on reciprocal and mutually beneficial basis. The word mutually beneficial basis is of great importance here, because trade agreement can never serve the purpose if they are not beneficial to all the signatory countries. So far, we have 16 FTAs, ASEAN being the biggest one. And probably it may be of surprise to many that even we have an agreement with China. Asia Pacific Trade Agreement has China as a member. So in effect, we have also given a preferential treatment to China in the free trade agreement. Now, as far as the role of various departments, you are already aware, commerce is the nodal ministry which negotiate and finalize the trade agreements. Various line ministries, depending on the issues involved, like agriculture, IT, electronics, fertilizer, etc., they also participate. But Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Custom is the main implementing body and has a very crucial stake on issues, mainly on tariff concessions, rules of origin, custom facilitation, and IPR. As you will be already knowing that in the trade agreement, duty concessions are extended only to such goods which are made in the exporting country. Each agreement contains a set of rules of origin which prescribe the criteria that must be fulfilled for such goods to attain originating status in that exporting country. They are based on factors such as value addition, substantial transformation in the course of manufacturing, etc. Now, by signing these agreements, whether we have benefited or not is a different issue and debatable issue. I will not touch that. But I will give you some figures to ponder about, because that is very relevant about when we talk about Karotar. ASEAN FTA, which is our biggest, it saw trade deficit rose from $5 billion in 2011 to $22 billion in 2019, from $5 to $22 billion. India-Japan from $4 billion to $8 billion. South Korean, $8 billion to $12 billion. In fact, a Niti Aayog's paper on free trade agreement and their cost very clearly points out that our export to FTA countries have not outperformed our overall export growth. With China, we have now trade deficit of almost 55 or 65 billion last year. Now, purpose of giving this information was to convey that FTA imports have a great cost unless they serve our they benefit us, and mainly if they are misused by fraudulent importer and exporters. During my 38 year active service in the department, about 17 years I have spent the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence. And we had very frequent instances of misuse where outright fraudulent imports were made and the goods just imported in that exporting country from some third country without any processing, without any value addition, were imported to India at the cost of not only the exchequer to the country, but to the domestic manufacturer. If I give you last 2 years' figure, DRI only has unearthed frauds to the extent of about 1,100 crores from April 2018 up to 2000. I think April 2000. Out of that, in 256 crore, they have already completed the investigation and issued notices. And 900 crore worth of cases are still under investigation. So basically, and then FTA have their own operational procedures, which are integral part of rules of origin and which guide the exporter and importer how to claim the benefit. They lay down what will be the form of country of origin, manner of issuing it, and process of origin verification. But there was a lacuna in our Customs Act, which had no specific provision to deal with FTAs and mainly the fraud therein. And in spite of having solid evidence that the import under FTA was total fraud, lot of time department lost the cases only because of the our law being totally silent, and with and there was no cooperation from the nodal authority of the exporting country. So there was a need for having something in our own law, at least to deal with the fraudulent imports under FTAs. And we had noticed that a lot of time there was total non-cooperation or sort of no interest shown by the nodal officers, nodal authorities of exporting country in helping us in our investigation. So that was a background where the law needed something to deal with such cases. And there and then now this Section 28 DA and the CAROTOR 2020 therein have come into existence. What they simply ask an importer is to do some basic due diligence before going ahead with your import from an exporter. We had cases where importers had even no knowledge about the respective FTAs under which they were importing their items. Some their agents or some brokers told them that why are you wasting your money in paying duty? I will get your import under FTAs. And without knowing the details of the FTA, without knowing everything there about, they indulged all these imports and later landed themselves in some problem. So what CAROTOR or what Section 28 DA basically says that you do some basic due diligence before you go ahead with your import. Now, during initial implementation of CAROTOR, there's a lot of complaints which we received in FICCI and which were flagged to CBIC also. And as PwC team may be telling you in the due course, CBIC had issued a circular yesterday, rather instruction to the officers, instruction number 20/2020, and instructing all the chief commissioners to have a strict supervision for the implementation of this CAROTOR by the officers in the field. And officers have been instructed that they should initiate inquiries on the origin of goods only when there is sufficient grounds is there to suspect the origin, or where same has been flagged as a risk by RMS, risk management system. I will stop here so that I will not take more time because so that you can go ahead with your main subject. Faceless assessment also, I would not like to waste your time and leave it to the my colleagues in PwC. I will only say that the basic purpose of this faceless assessment is to have a faceless, contactless and paperless customs, which was part of Turant Customs initiative by the CBIC. Aim is total anonymity, speedier customs, uniformity of the assessment, and a specialized assessment. There will be definitely some teething problem, which I am 100% sure that the CBIC will take care of. Now, I hand it over to my team in my colleagues in PwC to go into details of these two important issues. Thank you, Ira.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, thank you for sharing the background, and I think all of us who are there in the session today would be able to appreciate the objective that why CAROTOR is there. So those insights were really useful. And I think together with your perspective, we would be able to resolve the operational issues together. We at FICCI would also be supporting our members. Now, I would request Mr. Rahul Shukla. And before he takes up his presentation, I would just like to briefly introduce him. Mr. Rahul Shukla is a PwC national leader for customs, foreign trade policy, and SEZ matters. His expertise includes supporting and assisting clients in relation to day-to-day operational issues relating to import and export, related party valuation, claiming of export incentives, and advocacy on specific issues in customs, foreign trade policy, free trade agreements, and SEZ regulations. And he has also been a part of Global Customs and Trade Network and has been involved in undertaking process reviews vis-a-vis import and export transactions, including CTPAT validation and handling anti-dumping matters. He has been part of Single Window Committee of Department of Revenue on behalf of FICCI. And he has also partnered with EOE program Sale on Trade Outreach Activities. In fact, he has been part of Single Window Committee for Implementation of SWIFT. He was also a part of a taxpayer survey, which was taken in 2016 and 17 by FICCI. And he has been closely working on cross-border and trade facilitation initiatives with Ministry of Finance and is part of Custom Consultative Group of CBIC. Welcome to this session, sir. And Mr. Shukla, along with his colleague, Ms. Priya Singh, who is also a manager with PwC India, having 9 years of experience in rendering services in custom, trade, and SEZ-related matters. Priya is involved in assignments pertaining to a wide range of sectors such as consumer goods, FMCG, electronics, automotive, IT, telecom, etc. And she is part of core member of the execution team, engaged as knowledge partners to the task force constituted by the Ministry of Commerce to study the SEZ policy. So, over to you, sir, and Spriha, for the detailed insights for all the participants on CARITAR and FACELESS assessment. Thank you.
Thank you, Ira. Good afternoon, all the participants. Good afternoon, sir, and thanks, FICCI, for inviting us to be part of this masterclass. Sir has already set the context on the background to CARITAR and why it was needed and why it was operationalized. And there has been history to it since the time FTAs have been placed and we have an adverse balance of trade, and also there has been misuse around it. Faceless customs is a movement as part of revised Kyoto Protocol to deal with faster clearances, also allow a contactless environment where you don't need to go to the port and physically deal with the officer. So it's like an adoption of what is happening in corporate tax and income tax at the customs side, that everything will become online. And the idea is that there should be lesser dispute, faster clearances, and a uniformity of assessment and clearances practice. Since sir already has set the context on both the topics and we'll be taking it, I'm handing over to Spriya on the CARITAR part. Please, over to you, Spriya. Thank you. Priya, you can start. Priya, can you hear us? Ira, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you, yes.
I'm not sure whether Priya is able to hear me. I'm trying to... Priya, you are on mute. You have to start the session. Can you unmute yourself?
Okay. Am I audible to all now?
Yeah. Yes, you are.
Okay, so we have already got a background of why Karotawa was introduced, because of the rampant or widespread misuse of free trade agreements. And you know, somewhere over the last 10 years, the sacrosanct objective of the government of India, which was to sort of give benefit to imports happening from the countries, the FTA partner countries, that was being deviated from. And you know, all the routing and fudging of label and you know, non-originating goods were being imported. So that in that background, the government came up out with these Karotawa regulations. And if we are just to look at the overview of these changes, primarily these are legal provisions which have been introduced under the Customs Act, and then there are a set of rules which came about, which were implemented since 21st of September 2020. Now, if I have to just give a gist of what these changes are, first and foremost, these rules are assigning legal responsibility on the importer for all the declarations relating to Karotawa. So all the FTA-related declarations which the importer is now on going to make, they will be legally responsible for it. Then there are certain documentation and compliances which have been fastened on the importer legally, that it has been mandated that an importer has to be in possession of costing or value addition related information in respect of any FTA product that a company is importing into India from any of the FTA countries. The idea is that whoever is the real beneficiary, the importer in India, has to be in possession of such information, because you are making use of the FTA. That is the underlying objective. Third major change that has been introduced in through these amendments is that the customs authorities in India have been granted the power to verify any declaration or disclosure or information regarding usage of these FTAs at the stage of import itself. For example, when certain consignments are coming in at the port itself, there could be questions that could be asked from the importer, or at a later stage also, within a period of 5 years from the date of import. The authorities are very much within their right to ask these kind of questions around the origin of the goods, what are your products, where are they coming from, and from. So those kind of questions can be asked at the stage of import itself, or any time in the time frame of next 5 years. And not just the importer, but the authorities can actually go back to the counterpart authorities in the exporting countries. They can also go to the manufacturer exporter in the overseas country. Lastly, there have been specific consequences in terms of penalties and actions that have been introduced within the frame of Customs Act. Now, all in all, we are going to discuss all of these nuances and nitty-gritty of these changes in depth. But if we see that, you know, majorly there are four changes in terms of legal responsibility, documentation, power of verification, and lastly, the consequences. The whole idea is to strengthen the whole FTA regime, the FTA regime. Now, we are going to discuss what it means for businesses in terms of real, in terms of business reality, what these changes would mean, and you know, how the companies would actually need to prep up on certain aspects prior to making these imports, at the stage of import, and after import. So we have split all the action points the consequences that it has for businesses in three stages. So first I'm going to discuss the impact on a pre-import stage, and my colleague Sakshi is going to take the post-import stage. So this slide, as you all can see, we have summarized all the important aspects which a company needs to be mindful of prior to start using FTAs. First and foremost is, we need to evaluate whether our goods are wholly obtained or these are man-made products or processed goods. So wholly obtained goods would typically mean that goods which are, you know, which are earthly material or which occur naturally, such as plant, minerals, sea fish, or animal-based products. So these products are usually treated as wholly obtained, which would mean that this particular product is originating in the country of export itself. For example, if we take example of rice, now rice say grown in Malaysia would be treated as originating in Malaysia. So that will be treated as a wholly obtained product. Of course, subject to that product being covered in the FTA between India and Malaysia. So we have to first evaluate whether our product is wholly obtained, or the second category is whether the goods are made using non-originating material. So these would typically mean that these are processed goods or man-made goods. For example, your chocolates, all the FMCG products. So depending on what FTA we are talking about and what exactly is the coverage in that free trade agreement, we have to categorize our product between wholly obtained and goods which are prepared using non-originating material. So here we have covered an example of chocolates which are made in Malaysia and exported using ASEAN India Free Trade Agreement. Now chocolates is covered under ASEAN India Free Trade Agreement, and it is also covered in India-Malaysia bilateral free trade agreement. Now, one of the key requirements, why this is important, is because we have to first categorize our product under either of the buckets. And second, what we need to substantiate is that our product is actually, you know, made there or derived from that country, is originating in that country. Now, in example of chocolate, now sugar is a key ingredient. Sugar, cocoa paste, and emulsifiers and some preservatives are the key ingredients which go into making of a chocolate. Now imagine if sugar is one of the primary ingredients and it's sourced from China. Now China is not a part of India-ASEAN Free Trade Agreement. While these chocolates are finally made in Malaysia and exported from Malaysia to India using ASEAN-India Free Trade Agreement. Now one of the key requirements under ASEAN-India Free Trade Agreement is that from raw material stage to the final export product, there has to be a change in the tariff. There has to be 6-digit change in the tariff classification. That is, that the HS code of the raw material versus the HS code of the final product that is being exported from Malaysia, that should undergo a 6-digit tariff shift. Now, in this example, sugar, which is one of the main ingredients, was sourced from China, which is not a part of India-ASEAN Free Trade Agreement. Sugar is classified under HS code 1701-1490, whereas the chocolates are classified under HS code 1806-9010. Now we can clearly see that between the raw material or the ingredient sugar versus chocolate, there is a tariff shift which is more than 6-digit. Therefore, we can assume that the non-originating material, sugar in this case, is undergoing a 6-digit tariff shift, and you know it is meeting one of the most important criteria of the FTA. So this is like the starting point of evaluation when it comes to your export product, or when I say export product, it's the export product from that the overseas country and the product that is being imported into India. So we need to really look at whether my product is a wholly obtained product or is it a man-made or a processed product. Now and over there we also have to look at the tariff change criteria. Now the second most important aspect that a company needs to evaluate, or any business needs to evaluate before we start making use of free trade agreements, is the value addition calculation. So the value addition calculation, different percentages are prescribed depending on the FTA. Most of the FTAs say that there has to be a minimum 35% value addition in the country of export, meaning which, for example, if an electronic product is made in Korea and it is being exported from South Korea to India using India-Korea SEPA, in that case, that product should have achieved at least 35% value addition in Korea. So how this 35% is calculated, most of the FTAs actually ask you to add up. There are two methods. One is the direct method. The second one is indirect method. Under the direct method, the FTAs tell you to add up the value of all the originating raw material cost plus your labor cost plus your overheads like your manufacturing overheads plus profit that was made in the country of export, Korea in the example that I just gave, that divided by the FOB price of export from Korea. So if we just add up the Korean raw material plus your labor cost and the overheads and profit, and we divide by the final FOB price from Korea, that percentage should be greater than equal to 35%. Under the second method, the formula says that we have to take FOB price from the country of export, which is Korea in this example, and we subtract the value of all the non-originating material, that means all the non-Korean material in the example, and we divide by the final FOB price from the country of export, which is Korea in this case. That should be less than equal to 65. So there are two ways to look at it. Either there has to be a 35% originating content, or the reverse way to look at it is that there is 65% non-originating content. That is the highest tolerance which is allowed. Now, just to put things into perspective, we have made a simple illustration which can make things more clear. Again, we've picked example of a chocolate. Now, in this illustration, what we have done is we have assumed that chocolates are made in Malaysia, and the key ingredients to make a chocolate is sugar, cocoa paste, milk solids, and emulsifiers. And we have also mapped where these key ingredients are sourced from, because we just discussed that mapping the source country is very important, because we need to ascertain whether raw material is originating or non-originating. Now, in case of export product as chocolate from Malaysia, the key ingredients are sugar, cocoa paste, milk solids, and emulsifiers. And as we can see, sugar is sourced from China and cocoa paste has been sourced from Brazil, milk solids from Vietnam, and emulsifiers from Malaysia. Now, as a part of ASEAN-India Free Trade Agreement, Brazil and China are two countries which are not part of this this multilateral FTA. The ASEAN-India FTA covers all the ASEAN countries and India, the whole ASEAN bloc in India. Therefore, sugar is treated as non-originating and cocoa paste is also treated as non-originating. Whereas milk solids and emulsifiers, which are two major ingredients, these are being sourced from Vietnam and Malaysia. Therefore, these are treated as originating. Now, we have also assigned some hypothetical values to these raw material content, which is sugar. For sugar, we have $35. For cocoa paste, $20. And $6 for milk solids and emulsifiers, $8. Now, if we just add up, going by the two methods we discussed, under the direct method, we are going to add up the cost of all originating material, which is milk solid in this case, and emulsifiers. If we just add up that, and we also add up the labor cost and the overheads, the manufacturing overheads, which is $10, and we also add the profit, $4, that we divide by the FOB price of the chocolate exported from Malaysia, $83. And if we take it out as a percentage of the FOB price, it is coming out to be 33.73%, which is less than the threshold of 35% required. Therefore, our assessment is that this particular chocolate, even when made in Malaysia, is ineligible for the ASEAN-India FTA benefit. Now, a company which would have not done this backward working would actually inadvertently make use of the FTA without knowing that that they're not actually meeting the 35% value addition. So most of the companies make mistake here. They assume that, okay, my product is made in Malaysia and I've got the certificate of origin from the Malaysian Ministry of International Trade, that means I'm entitled for the ASEAN-India FTA benefit. But whereas when we do this calculation, we find out that they are actually not entitled for the benefit because they're not meeting the 35% threshold. Any questions so far?
Shreya, we'll take questions at the end of the session.
All right. So value addition becomes quite essential to evaluate in case of every product at a product level as well as SKU level, depending on the business model of the company. Then the third major criteria, and before I conclude the value addition part, I also want to highlight that when it comes to the overheads and costing, there have been a lot of instances where we have heard from the industry and companies that, you know, sharing the costing related information becomes a little tricky for the overseas entity because the Indian importer becomes aware of the profit of the overseas entity. And, you know, while it may still be possible in case of related party transactions when Indian importers are importing from group companies, but this becomes more complicated when Indian importers are actually importing goods from unrelated party or third party vendors or, you know, or some trader sitting overseas. As difficult as it may sound, but the idea is that the idea is to plug the leakage of revenue or you know, to sort of at least curb the rampant misuse or inadvertent non-compliance, especially in those kind of instances where value addition is not being met. Now we'll move to the next criteria, which is the de minimis. Now some of the FTAs actually prescribe a minimum tolerance level of non-originating material. These are, for example, India-Japan FTA very clearly talks about a de minimis rule. Some of the FTAs are silent on the de minimis rule. So the de minimis rule says that there has to be a minimum threshold of non-originating material that can be allowed within the overall FOB price component breakdown of the export product. Now, just to simplify, I have put an example for India-Japan FTA. Now, there are certain parts of machine which under HS code 84-31-20, which are covered under India-Japan SEPA. Now, India-Japan SEPA says that the total value of non-originating materials used in the production should not exceed beyond 10% FOB price. So what it says is that essentially that the non-Japanese raw material cannot be more than 10% of the FOB price. Now in this example, what we've done is we have assumed that this particular part is made of two components. One is of the Japanese origin. The other component is of the Malaysian origin. Now the final part is being assembled or manufactured in Japan, and it is being exported from Japan to India using India-Japan SEPA. Now, as we can see, we have also assigned certain hypothetical values to these components. The component which is being sourced from Malaysia is for a value of $15, and this will be treated as non-Japanese, therefore this is non-originating component. Now, the overall FOB price of the export product from Japan is, say, $50. In such a case, we can see that this is, you know, the component which is being sourced from Malaysia is comprising of 30% of the FOB price, and the tolerance level prescribed under Japan SEPA is only 10%. Therefore, this component will not be qualifying as originating material. So these aspects become very critical when we have to look at eligibility to you before using an FTA. Then the next important criteria is substantive processing. Now, the overall, as we, you know, started in the beginning of the discussion, that the whole idea of these rules and all these procedural requirements is that a real value addition should have happened in the country of export, a real manufacturing should have happened in that country of export, which is why all the FTAs give you instances that, you know, what kind of activities are sort of disqualified as real manufacturing or a substantial processing. So some of the FTAs very clearly say that, you know, if you're simply mixing two ingredients and making a third product, that's not a tangible value addition. That is not a real or a substantive transformation that has happened. Likewise, if there's a bulk pack which is broken into a lot of smaller packs, that will again not qualify as some substantive transformation. Similarly, packing, repacking, and just affixing label, because there have been a lot of instances where goods were made in China, they were routed through Vietnam, and only a sticker was affixed in Vietnam. Or let's say a bigger pack was broken into smaller packs, and you know a relabeling was done. So that is not a real value addition. So all these FTAs typically give these kind of examples that you know what activities do not qualify as substantial processing. So for every product that we are importing, we have to go back to the overseas team and understand that, you know, we have to at least understand the outline or an overview of the manufacturing process that should have happened overseas to conclude that, you know, there has been a substantive processing that took place in the country of export of the manufacturing country before we start making use of FTAs. Then last couple of aspects which a company needs to look at is that if there are any product specific rules of origin prescribed for a particular product. So some of these FTAs actually tell you to look at mandatorily comply with the product specific rules. So while 35% value addition may be prescribed generally, but for some products there could be a rider that you have to comply, there has to be a 40% value addition, let's say. So then and the FTA may say that it is mandatory to comply with the product specific rule. So in that case, the importer will have to go for 40% value addition. So we have to look at these nitty-gritty before we start making use of the FTA. And last is that rule of accumulation or the concept of accumulation. Now this concept is mainly important in case of FTA countries, in case of block FTA countries or multilateral FTA countries, for example, ASEAN India FTA, that comprises of good number of 11 countries. Now, some part of the value chain would have happened in some components would have been sourced from Indonesia, some from Malaysia, some from Thailand, whereas the final manufacturing, let's say, took place in Vietnam. Now, all the raw material or the components which were sourced from Indonesia, Thailand, Philippines, and other ASEAN countries, that will be factored in the value addition calculation. So this concept is nothing but adding up or factoring in the raw material which is being sourced from the FTA countries. So these are some of the concepts that one needs to be mindful of before one starts making use of the FTAs. So now these were the conditions that we discussed that, you know, we have to, which a business needs to prepare before starting to make use of FTAs. Now my colleague Sakshi is going to take up all the conditions or documents or disclosures which a company needs to make at the time of import.
Thank you, Spriya. Hi, everyone. When we talk about the disclosures and the compliances that an importer has to make at the time of import due to Karotar, we can segregate it into two parts. First part being the declarations that an importer has to make at the time of filing the bill of entry. This begins with first thing, the importer, when he files his bill of entry, he has to mention whether the goods are qualifying as originating goods or not under the respective FTA. He has to indicate the specific serial number and the reference of the tariff notification against which he's claiming the benefit. In addition to these, he would be producing the certificate of origin for each item that he's importing. And lastly, he would be mentioning various details of the certificate of origin. Details such as the reference number, issuance date, originating criteria, whether accumulation or accumulation has been applied, various other things. Now, once these declarations are made, in case the goods are not wholly obtained, then there's some other compulsory details that an importer must maintain with himself. Now, these are, for example, whether the goods that he's importing from the exporting country, has the exporter produced them himself or has he procured it locally from a third party? In case he has procured it locally from a third party, has he sought a confirmation and documentary proof whether those goods are meeting originating criteria or not? Whether various rules like change in tariff, process rule, de minimis, accumulation, accumulation, are all these rules applying on the goods that are being imported into the country? Then has the certificate of origin been issued retrospectively, or has the consignment that is coming been directly shipped from a country of origin? These are the very limited details that an importer must keep in mind at the time of import under CAROTAR. Now, once the import goods have come to India and they have to be cleared, the verification process begins. The verification process can be briefly divided into two parts. The first part, being an idle part, is that an importer, he files his bill of entry and he submits his FTA claim. The customs officer thereafter wants to do a verification, and he tells the importer various other details that he's required to submit, and he'll give him a timeline of 10 days to submit those details. In the ideal situation, the importer submits all the details to the satisfaction of the officer, and within 15 days, the officer clears the claim and a favorable order is passed. Now, this is under the ideal situation. In a second situation, when the importer is not able to provide the information, or the information that he's giving is not sufficient, or the officer has any reason whatsoever to believe that the goods that are being imported do not meet the origin criteria. In such an instance, the officer is in his power to forward a verification request to the verification authority in the exporting country. This request would obviously go through the nodal officer. And when he makes this request, he has to indicate the response timeline also to the verification authorities, which is generally 60 days. Once the request has been made, there are only two things that can happen. One is that the information comes to the Indian customs authorities, or no information comes. If no information comes, the officer is within his power to deny the claim. But if the information comes, the officer has to complete the verification process in the next 45 days. And if he finds it satisfactory, he can allow the claim. Now, during this entire verification process, the goods that have come, what will happen of those goods? For those goods, the preferential tariff treatment will be suspended meanwhile, and the verification authority to whom the verification request has gone will be informed of such suspension. Or the importer has an option to undertake request for provisional assessment of his goods, but he will have to furnish a security which will be equivalent to the amount, differential amount between provisionally assessed amount and the preferential duty claimed by him. Lastly, I would want to discuss what are the non-compliances, or more like what amounts to non-compliance under CAROTAR, and what would eventually be its consequences. When I talk about the non-compliances, they can be segregated into three major parts. First being those instances where the benefit will be denied outrightly. These can be instances where an importer, he is declaring an incorrect tariff item, okay, or he's giving incomplete description or in his certificate of origin. Or let's say he's furnishing an expired certificate of origin, or the CEO has any alteration in it. These cases will result in outright denial. Next is if the importer is making any false declaration. That declaration can be deliberate, then only would it apply to, it will amount to non-compliance. Now there are various other small instances also for which an importer can be held to be non-compliant. These can be, there's a manipulation of the value addition norms. The importer has affixed false labels, or he has just inflated his profit to, like, you know, achieve value addition. Or there's very minimal activity that has been undertaken in the country of export. Or let's say he has not managed to retain the documents that he was supposed to for a period of 5 years as prescribed by the CAROTAR rules. All these instances would eventually amount to non-compliance by the importer. If an importer is non-compliant under CAROTAR, the consequences that fall upon him would be consequences such as loss of reputation. He will obviously lose his FTA benefit. He can even lose his AO status. He can be asked to furnish additional security. There can be scrutiny of all his historical imports for the last 5 years, and where an allegation of fraud can be made on him under Section 28(4). There can be confiscation of his imported goods, and he can be asked to pay a redemption fine. There can be highest levels of penalty, risk of criminal prosecution, and obviously a very long-drawn litigation process. These are the nuances under CAROTAR at the time post-import and the non-compliances. Now I'll request Priya to summarize the CAROTAR part with the key takeaways.
Thank you, Sakshi. So all in all, we've just given a brief synopsis of what these changes are and what it means. If we just have to conclude this part, is that now whatever declarations that are being made in respect of FTA usage, the legal onus or responsibility completely lies on the importer. The importer cannot shrug off his responsibility by saying that, look, I did not know that my overseas entity or my supplier sitting in ASEAN country was not complying with the value addition because I was completely trusting him and what was written on the certificate of origin. That will not sail through because now there has been expressly a legal responsibility which has been fastened on the importer. He is responsible for claiming the benefit and all the disclosures and declarations that have been made, unless he can prove that, you know, that he has been also manipulated. For example, I mean, I cannot be made liable if my overseas, if the trader, if the supplier sitting in Singapore manipulated me, fudged the documents and cheated me. So for in that kind of scenario, of course, I have to again prove that I was not colluding with my overseas supplier. But unless that kind of exceptional situation is there, I'm completely responsible for making the FTA claim. Second, I need to be prepped up with a host of aspects, which I need to look at in a micro detail in terms of value addition, origin, and how the product was being made, how the product has come into being in the country of export, the entire manufacturing process. So I as a business need to be prepped up with all those information before I start making the claim. And if in case I've been historically making use of FTAs, it's about time that I go back and check whether all the products that I've been importing for so many umpteen number of years and I've been claiming FTA benefit, was I really entitled for that benefit? So I need to look at my value addition and all those minute aspects. Third is that the authorities can definitely ask for information at the stage of import itself or anytime in 5 years time frame. And of course, it has consequences. So these are the aspects that we should be mindful of. So I think that's all from my side on CAROTAR. I'll now request Rahul sir to take up the next topic.
Thank you, Spriya. So before I move on to faceless customs, just certain concluding aspects in CAROTAR. CAROTAR, as it started from 21st September 20, and there has been challenges which trade are facing. Also, there has been change in bank guarantee norms for AEOs as well if they are using FTA. So even if you are an AEO and you are eligible for concessional bank guarantee benefits, that has been taken away if your verification is happening under CAROTAR. As per the CAROTAR regulations, so one has to be mindful of that as well. There has been challenges also where the, you know, at times while the law says that you have to file, you have to only furnish form one when only the risk management system asks for it, but in past instances have happened where the assessing groups have asked for form one, though RMS has not pushed that, and that has led to a lot of disruptions on clearances and damages. People have incurred damages. Yesterday's board clarification also on that, because almost everywhere the verification request is going to the nodal authority and board, and at some period the proper protocols are not being followed. Multiple queries are being raised, which is leading to delay in clearances also. So trade is also represented to the board, and somewhere the field is also reaching out. So I would say that there are challenges on the both sides, but yes, it's a compliance reality which the trade has to live with it, given that it's provided under the Customs Act, given the previous past misuses and issues. One can say that FTA rules of origin did have all these these things there, and why it needs to be replicated here, as Mr. Singh has clarified in his opening statement or remark, that this was more to do empower customs and put a larger onus on the importer post the self-assessment. Importer has the responsibility to do and to undertake all the suitable compliances as part of integrated declaration. So the trade has to be mindful of all these expectations. If there are issues, I think it's better to reach out and seek clarification, because somewhere customs as a part of EODB also speaks of trade customs partnership, which can be done. So from that, moving to another topic, customs faceless assessment, we can move to this section. So if one understand one technological usage or technology usage in cross-border trade and from an audit tool perspective, facilitation assessment perspective has been there, and India endorsed a trade facilitation agreement in 2016. And after that, National Committee on Trade Facilitation were formed, a lot of action items were, if I recall correctly, 72 plus items were recognized. And we also said we will go apart from A++ commitment, which are not there in the TFA. But India agreed that they will go ahead and do some of their own. And in this journey, if you see, from 2011, a lot of things have changed. We have moved from assessment by authorities to self-assessment, where the responsibility is on the importer, minimization of documents, so you can now give invoice, cum packing list, etc., digital signature, AEO program came into place, single window interface for trade facilitation came into play. So all the participating government agencies' approval are coming through the portal rather than the multiple applications being given to different authorities for getting the approval. Integrated declaration also enabled for the PGAs and the customs to look into the assessment in a very holistic manner. Apart from that, then e-Sanchit also came into play, so there will be no physical document that needs to be filed. Everything needs to be mandatorily uploaded into the ICEGATE through e-Sanchit. Apart from the e-sealing of the containers also is in play now. Deferred custom duty also came into play. Also, mandatory requirement of payment of duty within 24 hours. Then the post-clearance audit also gets started, where it changed from port-based audit to scheme theme-based audit or premise-based audit. And the biggest change was the Turant customs. That everything that now we are talking of Turant is mean instant and immediate. And in that part, we have come out with e-out of charge, e-gate pass, digital transmission of bill of entries and shipping bills to the importer, and automated customs verification, and the requirement to register the goods. Suomoto importer can register the goods before the payment of duty was also enabled. And with that came the faceless assessment. The idea of faceless assessment was more to do with the objective that instead of going to the ports, as has been the practice, where the CHA goes to the port and files the bill of entry, and the groups deal with the bills of entry, and there can be issues around assessments, as different interpretation of practices may prevail, different requirements may prevail, different documentation aspects will come up. To remove all that and to make it as a part of EODB measure and improve our ranking on the cross-border trade, we came out with the concept of faceless customs, that nobody needs to go to customs. Customs will be online. It will be a paperless custom. That means everything has to be uploaded through e-Sanchit, which now they are mandated in their yesterday's clarification, that all the documents now need to be mandatorily uploaded in the e-Sanchit. Nothing will be given physically, effectively from 21st December onwards. And contactless customs, basically that you don't need to meet me. Everything will be done, so you have to have an out of charge, it will be e-out of charge. If you need a gate pass, it will be e-gate pass. If it's a custom compliance verification, it will be done online by the officer, apart from even on-site or using the tool where they can do a sample transaction-based clearance audit as well, from changing their role from an appraising officer to audit officer. So that in nutshell is the concept of Turant custom that got rolled out, which is now gaining momentum with the rollout of faceless customs. Next slide, please. So what has happened in Turant customs so far? First of all, reduced customs time. Also, there has been facilitation from a minimal documentation requirement, faster clearances, because now you have to pay duty immediately. Otherwise, there are penal consequences on non-payment of duty within 24 hours of lending or assessment of bill of entry. And then the faceless customs. Next slide, please. So what has been the faceless customs journey so far? So pilot program started with Chennai and Bangalore zone sometimes in August, and a lot of tests were done, and the specific chapters were picked up, 84 and 85, and feedback was taken. Even public was asked to comment on that sometimes in 19 on the faceless customs aspect and approach. After that, to align with the Turant customs and faceless customs concept, e-out of charge, then the faceless customs was launched in June. 22nd June, again, digital copies were rolled out, that they need to be in a physical copy, etc. And Turant Suvidha Kendras were also established, which were mandated to be established at every port for any assistance on defacing of bill of entry, licenses, etc., execution of bank guarantees. So you don't need to do anything physically. Everything will be online or portal-based. And then phase two started, where the expansion of phase one, which earlier involved only Chennai and Bangalore, to involve other ports. And then earlier, the objective was to roll out this concept of phaseless customs by end of December. But then it was, given the experience and success, just stay on the previous slide, please, Sachin. It was advanced to 31st October, and the pan-India rollout has happened. Next slide, please. So what has happened? So the key concept of phaseless customs, if you look at the organization structure, what has been constituted is a national assessment center comprising of 11 national NACs, which are based on the chapters under the Customs Tariff Act. And the NACs have been formulated basis their share or their revenue share or import share of that particular product category or product group in the zones. So NACs have been formed from that. The principal chief commissioner or the chief commissioner are the coordinators for that, and the nodal officer is nodal principal commissioner of that zone. NAC then goes to the faceless assessing group. So every port has faceless assessing groups or faceless assessment groups, we call it FAGs, which are again distributed pan-India basis, and they have given responsibility on the chapters they will be dealing with. And NAC also has been mandated to have an oversight on the functioning of FAGs, which is faceless assessment groups. And they will have their working committees to look into the assessment of bill of entries, any coordination they need to do with PGAs, other authorities, DGARM, DRI, trade. Also look at the classification related issues, disputes, valuation related issues, all that. There will be working groups which will be looking into it. There will be periodical web meetings and exchanges on how the things are going on. Also monitoring of assessment, because idea of FAG is that it will be 24/7. So the adequacy of manpower to support FAGs will be there. So in case if there, the volume or the load on FAGs will be assessed, there will be dashboards, ISTABs access as well. Commissioners can look into the performance of FAGs, etc. And below FAG, the JPCs or the port assessing groups, we called as JPCs or FAGs, will continue the way them. They will be supporting FAG. So FAG will only deal with bills of entry that custom automated system will push to them. Otherwise, other bill of entry will still be dealt by at FAG. At time, FAGs also will push the certain bill of entries to FAG or the port assessing group, or even commissioner at the port can also pull these bills of entry in specific circumstances. And at the port, there will be Turant Suvidha Kendra. They'll be supporting the FAGs or the port assessing group and the trade on certain services, which will be manned by customs. Next slide, please. So National Assessment Commissionerate, I have already touched upon that, that it will be monitoring the assessment practice of FAGs and to ensure uniformity of practice. And yesterday's circular talks about it. They have highlighted that the reassessment is not being done, speaking order is not being issued. They also highlighted that trade is not giving complete information on the product description, while integrated bill of entry has the facility to provide generic description, specific description, brand and brand. So they have explained how this can be done. Also, they have also mentioned that not every document is getting uploaded on eSanchit. So that has now been mandatory done, that every document that goes now needs to be uploaded in eSanchit. They also need to ensure that they have become the knowledge repository, and they also deal with industry's issue. And also I may monitor that how the interaction with FAGs and PAGs are happening and how the efficiency is going on. And to that extent, yesterday's clarification also stated that the monetary limit for an appraiser has been increased from 1 lakh to 5 lakh, because earlier there used to be two-step assessment where the appraiser used to assess, then it used to go to the deputy commissioner or assistant commissioner. Now that has been changed. Now it will be up to 5 lakhs, and then there will be a 10% transactional clearance audit that will be done. So all these interventions, NACs will be looking into it. Faceless customs will be headed by ACs and assistant commissioners or deputy commissioners. They will have pan-India jurisdiction for the chapter they are dealing with, and they the customs automated system will be randomly allotting them the bill of entries, which they will be assessing. And they will be so dealing. So if I am filing a bill of entry in Delhi, and it can go, it can be picked up depending upon the group of the chapter I am in, maybe person sitting in Chandigarh or maybe Calcutta, who will be dealing with the assessment. So I will not be interacting with him or at the port. Everything will be done through EyesGate only. Next slide. So if I try to summarize this, what was earlier before the faceless regime and now, if you look at the earlier experience, and I'm held to the Chennai, which is the first pilot that happened. Prior to faceless customs rollout, you used to file the bill of entry, or the trade used to file the bill of entry through the customs broker, and it used to be dealt at the port, where the appraising you used to do it, and the first check used to happen, second check used to happen, you used to register the bill of entry, register the goods, and the pay duty assess and out of charge used to happen. And the whole contingent of officers used to sit in the import shed, etc., and deal with the assessment. In faceless group, now the customs automated system becomes the crux of this, and it will pick up the bill of entry based on profiling or requirements randomly, and will push it to faceless assessment group for assessment purposes, which will be sitting at various jurisdictions under the NACs. And there will be one FAG, and then FAG will be supported by JPCs, because in some cases, when faceless assessment group is assessing the bill of entry, they may find that there are challenges, they may need to have a first check done, they may need further information, or they may need a second check in certain circumstances, or there is a requirement of amendment under Section 149 of the documentation, or the importer requires that kind of intervention. So in that case, the bill of entries, FAG will push it to port assessing group for instructions on what to be done, either in first check or examination or verification or carrying out further test and seeking certain pertinent information. At times also, FAGs can push the bill of entries which have been assigned to them to PAGs or the port assessing group, where they feel that there is a prohibition or against these goods, or these are valuation issues, or there are specific instances of possible violation, or it requires further examination before assessment can happen. So that can be done on the approval from the commissioner, at the level of joint commissioner and above, and then PAGs will take it. At that time, at times, port assessing group can also pull bill of entry, or the commissioner can decide to pull a bill of entry which has been assigned to faceless groups, where they feel that there is an issue, either a possible risk management system is highlighted, a possible suppression or a misdeclaration, a violation. So that's how the entire ecosystem of faceless customs continue. Next slide, please. So this is more a broad description of how the information access of goods are imported. BOE is filed. BOE enters into custom automated system. Custom automated system will push it to FAGs, and then the FAGs will do the verification. And if they accept the assessment by the importer, they will simply clear it, or they will, if they are not, they will reassess and pass a speaking order. That's the norm as it prevails today as well. Next slide, please. So FAGs, what will they do? They will verify, they will ask, accept the self, or they can order a first check or a second check. They can return the BOE for payment and also grant out of charge where everything is fine if they are accepting it. If not, before acceptance, they can order a first check or a second check, where they will ask the PAG at the port to do the check, either the shed level or otherwise, or seek other information through e-sanchit on the lab reports, examination report, other documents. Wherever they are reassessing, stay there. Wherever they are reassessing, they have to pass a speaking order for reassessment, which needs to be accepted by the importer. And if the importer agrees, the bill of entry has to be assessed and returned for payment of duty, and out of charge has to be given. At times when the goods are liable to confiscation and adequate information, are that if the faceless assessment group sees that given that information that is required for assessment, it is going to take significant time, or the importer is unable to adequately provide such information, they will push recommend for a provisional assessment, and they will push these bills of entry to PAGs or the port assessing group to do the needful and assess them. So they will be taken out from the FAG queue or the faceless assessment group. Next. So port assessment group, if you look into it, they will continue to work the way they are, and they will be dealing with the bill of entries that are not marked to the FAG by the customs automated system. They will perform all the functions of assessment, examination, reassessment, and also all the bill of entries that are referred back by the FAGs or the faceless assessing group to them, where there is a restriction or there is a possible. Also, they will also deal with the normal request of bank guarantee acceptance or waiver of late fees, amendment, or storage of goods in the warehouse under Section 49, etc. to support these functions at the trade level or the port level, there will be a Turan Suvidha Kendra, which now has been mandated to be established at every port, where the customs, it will be manned by customs. So any requirement during the assessment for acceptance of bond or bank guarantee or devasing, etc., or debiting of licenses, etc., will be handled through these TSK. So the load on the PAGs or the, will be minimal, and these requests will be routed through TSKs to the e-Sanchit. Next slide. Apart from that, the faceless assessment will also deal with adjudication, and they have to pass order. Their orders will be appealable as well, and as per the normal course, and they are the jurisdictional commissioner who has the charge of their court, commissioner appeals, and they have to also the bill of entry amendment can also be done. There are clarification issued on where the bill of entry has not been given out of charge. So if the bill of entry has not been given out of charge, and assessment has no reassessment or amendment request has no impact on the duty outflow or the incidence, then it will be assigned back to the same pack which has done the assessment earlier. So all these cases will be handled as per the time-to-time clarifications that CVIC has issued in recent past. And they will be giving opportunity of hearing if they are reassessing and they have to pass a speaking order. And review proceeding also will be the same as what as was earlier in case of FAG assessments as well. Next slide. So what is the impact of faceless assessment? If we look into it, the objective that customs is trying to achieve is uniformity of assessment, predictability, lesser dispute. So it reduces dwell time. It also reduces the transaction cost because there will be no physical interface. There's no requirement to give physical document. Everything will be uploaded. Anybody can see his. And two, with the FAGs, they expect a specialization come into the assessment. So people who have an expertise and exposure in a particular chapter, given that the FAGs have been or NACs have been assigned based on the volume of trade being handled at that particular zone or the quantum of revenue collected on those product chapters or product goods, the expectation is that there will be a faster clearances because there will be a predictability and knowledge which these FAGs or the authorities will have. Also, it will bring in professionalism and transparency and better consistency with maybe in future lower disputes. So that will help India to move to an EODP rank, which we are currently aiming at 50, and also further digitization and lesser dependence on physical document, because storing or handling physical documents even in a custom house becomes a thankless job. And we have seen cases, and Sarkar bear with me, every custom house has a challenge of storing all these documents in the malkhanas or the seized documents or confiscated documents, etc. So somewhere this will help. And since this will be a fast track clearances that India is adopting, and somewhere this was also taken up as part of the intervention from a pandemic perspective, this will help further encouragement to invest, to trade, to look into India as a hub where it is enabling through technology intervention faster turnarounds. Next slide, please. So what you need to do, because somewhere the enhancing custom, it's a customs and trade partnership that has been spoken about since 2014, and we have been interacting with customs in a lot of outreaches, and we have done a lot of outreaches on a lot of topics with customs at various ports. So somewhere trade also needs to take a onus of face on the expectation from them, given they are already in the self-assessment. They need to look at their disclosures, their documentation, and also the SOPs, internal trainings. And also if they are relying on custom broker, they have to also get their teams up and running, up to speed on their technical or technological expertise and exposures, including updates on customs requirements, procedure, etc. So there are minimum errors, etc. And they need to also shift focus on how their internal controls and processes are further enhanced, so that they can take benefit of these trade facilitation measures, especially if you are in an AU environment and you are enjoying a lot of facilitation from a risk management system. On custom sides, yes, the expectation is there has been challenges. We have been hearing that at times there has been challenges in the system where the document cannot be seen either at the FAG end or the PAG, and at times the importer is not aware his consignment is pending with a particular faceless group, but he has no update, etc., and he is incurring damages. So these are the teething troubles. Also, the expectation is that these FAGs or the PAGs will continue to look into the objective of the faceless customs and reduce queries, which has been clarified yesterday's circular as well, that the queries has to be standardized and looked by NAC, etc. So there are no repetitive queries and further outreaches needs to be done. And also the expectation is the officers' rotation has to be kept in mind with the specialization that is being looked into. That will be the expectation from the trade. So the objective of faceless custom, that these groups are manned by experts who are subject experts or chapter experts, are is a consistent experience as it move forward. So there are minimal investigations, minimal disputes. So this is all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Indeed, very useful presentation. All the aspects covered, indeed, very valuable and very valuable insights. Thank you, Priya and Sakshi as well. I think we can, there are a few questions I can see in the Q&A box. Should I read the questions for you?
Yeah, no, you can.
So this one question is by Mr. Indra Vikram Singh. His question is, suppose the exporter gives a declaration on its letterhead, duly signed and stamped, that value addition done by it is more than 35% or the minimum percentage required for value addition for qualifying for FTA benefits. Is this document sufficient for importer? And he's saying 30% value addition is achieved.
See, Ira, first of all, it will depend upon the value addition under the particular FTA. And if, first of all, you will have a certificate of origin that you will be uploading, as Sakshi has pointed out on the presentation. And that will that always carry the value addition because it is mentioned there. And it also carries the tariff shift or what is the basis of issuance of certificate of origin. And if a Form 1 request has been given where there's elaboration being asked, merely a declaration from exporter may not suffice, because how that 35% is achieved is critical to Indian customs, as Spreya pointed out, and we have seen cases, and sir also pointed out his experience of DRI, that we have seen cases where the non-originating material was there, or we have seen cases where the non-originating material was largely used and value addition has been used by other aspects like profits, overhead costs, etc., to arrive at the 35% benchmark. And that's where the Indian customs concern has been. We have been interacting and we have appeared recently in some investigations also, not related to Karotar or otherwise. The view is that exporting country is simply issuing certificate, and that's the view we have heard otherwise as well. And the compliance is not there. So if an exporter is simply giving this declaration, in my view, this may not suffice, because ultimately the objective of Karotar is to understand how you have confirmed that 35%. A declaration is a declaration. It doesn't give a breakup of how 35% is achieved.
You
go ahead.
I'd just like to add something here that, first of all, the expectation from an importing company or any importer making use of an FTA is that you have to maintain such information in 100% of the import transactions. It is the prerogative of the customs that when and if they have certain doubt or they have certain concerns or they have certain intelligence or they feel that this product may not be actually made in Singapore, but this may be routed, or maybe there is no value addition happening. So it's an industry-wide issue for that particular product. Or there could be umpteen number of reasons why those questions are being posed to you as an importer. So the expectation is that 100% of the cases, you have to be in possession of that information. It is only when and if the authorities ask you that question, you have to furnish that information. Now, when and if they ask you that information, then you are under a legal obligation to submit that information. Which is why that declaration from the overseas will not suffice, because there must have been a doubt. That's why they asked you the question in the first place.
Thank you, Spreya. I think very important aspect that the 100% documentation has to be maintained. So I think in continuation to that query, Mr. Indra Vikram Singh has put in another question. In case of companies purchasing parts for different parts of world and assembling and selling the finely assembled products, whose HS code is different from any other parts used in it. Will it qualify for FTA benefits as HS code has changed, whether or not?
HS code is one of the sacrosanct criteria, definitely, but that alone will not suffice because there are other criteria also. There has to be the 35% value addition also in terms of costing. We have to look at, we have to add up all the originating material. For let me make a hypothetical example for ease of understanding of the entire group. Assume that there are certain components being sourced from Germany, some from Japan, some from China, and the final assembly is done in Vietnam, and now they will have certain XHS code. Now the final final equipment which was assembled and made in Vietnam and exported from Vietnam, that has YHS code. So there is a tariff shift. However, we cannot forget the other golden rule, which is calculation of the 35% value addition. When we do that calculation, we'll have to add up all the Vietnamese and other ASEAN based components and raw material. That we'll add up with the overheads and profit. So which I'm assuming that, you know, since all the components are non-ASEAN origin, in this case, 35% may not be achieved. So just because you have achieved that tariff shift between the components versus the final export product, that alone will not suffice.
I would just like to add here, what Mr. Shukla and Shipra has said, that basically lot of these questions can be answered if the importer go through the details of FTA. These answers are contained in the FTA itself. And one of the objective of this CAROTAR and Section 28(2)A, a DA under which this CAROTAR is issued, is telling you to go through that FTA at least. If you read that FTA, you will get all these answers. The problem was that you were not bothering to even read the FTA before going for the import.
Thank you, sir. Very important observation. I think Spriha also, during her presentation, that one need to look at the FTA before before the import, they need to look into FTA. I think very important observation share. There's another question from Mr. Sarvesh Rathi. How to deal if assessing officer raised query, provide all RBC data duly authorized by statutory auditor of supplier? How anyone can share RBC data? This is price sensitive information. Nobody discloses its business confidential information. So
Ira, I would like to answer to this. I think this is a fairly common, and I would say that it's a frequently asked question, and every client that we deal with has the same concern. And you know, more so that, you know, there are situations where Indian companies are actually dealing with their parent companies or overseas related affiliates. In those cases, getting that price sensitive information may still be possible. But when we are doing business with completely unrelated entity or a third vendor altogether, getting this information becomes a little tricky, and we do understand that. But the idea is that we have to comply. So, you know, from a business reality perspective versus, you know, how to maintain that balance between being compliant versus, you know, adequacy of the disclosure versus you know, the business reality also, that we have to be mindful of what we have suggested to some of the companies is that you can get the information around your originating raw material cost on a cumulative basis, your overheads. And, you know, between your overheads and profit, don't give the split. But at least, you know, give a cumulative amount of
We are unable to hear you. Your voice is breaking.
So that, and you have to give a breakdown of all your ingredients or core product. So with the bare minimum information, try to find a balance where you can get the information.
Priya, we are losing you.
Disclosing the actual amount of profit. Completed. I'm not too sure which part was not heard. But what I was trying to explain was that it's... Sir, you may take up the answer to this question if...
Yeah, because we are losing you. So, what, Ira, so I will try and answer, take up whatever I can hear, what I heard from Priya, is that, see, this is a common challenge we are hearing from the clients about the confidentiality and the RVC and challenge, and we have been discussing with authorities as well. The issue that is coming out here is, if you look at the way the rules have come out, they say Form 1. Form 1 says you have to give me details of RVC. And also give key components how the RVC is arrived. Also, it also says that you also list out the key components which are used in your manufacturing, whether they are originating, non-originating, have you taken confirmation. So that's the first exercise. Then the FAQ that was released by CBIC said that you don't need to give confidential information, give the information which is available with you around us to support these kind of requirements. And we are aware that a lot of customs formations are asking these questions. They are also insisting on getting the verification, direct importers asking importers to get these things verified from the exporting country, and asking a lot of informations on getting suppliers invoice, raw material invoice, or suppliers raw material invoice samples, etc., and other aspects. And there have been a number of piecemeal queries, and yesterday's circular also took this up, that first of all, you have to first assess that the risk management system, has it raised these queries? Have they picked it up? Is it a very sensitive issue? Then you decide on what information you need to know. And somewhere, that's how it has to build. That's what the direction has been given yesterday for the assessing group. Having said that, when we talk to or interact with customs authority, they say they are guided by what is there under the CAROTAR and what they are supposed to do. And some bit of what has been provided in the FAQ. So at times, they also need guidance to what extent they have to go. So I think somewhere a convergence has to happen between trade and customs, and somewhere CBIC needs to also look into an outreach and form a bridge between what is that is expected, and take a feedback both from trade and customs field formation on the challenges they are facing. Some has been taken. That's why yesterday's circular covers some of these grounds from a verification perspective. Because in a lot of cases, if you are unable to give these kind of information, the ultimate resort to any customs officer is to request for a verification and send it to the CBIC nodal officer for further verification request.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. So, in fact, on the FAQs, I think maybe would you like to share your observation on, like, there is a FAQ, whether it is being followed by the authority, so that in case there is an implementation issue, then there's no issue with the policy direction. But what are the, I just wanted to have your views, what are the challenges in terms of implementation, whether there's a lack of some policy direct, because as you mentioned, there are a lot of circulars and which are being issued. So would you like to share some insights based on your experience with your clients? And
so, Ira, if you look at the trade side, when all this started, and while 21st August, these rules came out and it was to be rolled out by 21st September, and a lot of representations at that time went to CBIC, and that time e-invoicing also was on the roll, that extension may be given. But I think the view of CBIC was there, that this was there in March. We have brought in this out on as amendment under the Finance Act and Customs Act, Section 228DA. So the company importer should have been ready and expected this to happen, because this is more than visible the way things are going. We had cases where goods which are non-originating were routed through countries on availment of duty exemption benefit. A lot of these information and news have come in the public domain as well. So when the CAROTAR came out and the Form 1, etc. came out, Form 1, if you look at it, requires you to provide, for bill of entry, you have to provide information on the items that are covered in that particular bill of entry. Then you have to give manufacturing process. Then you also need to give items which are the key items which are which goes into the manufacturer, whether they are originating, non-originating, whether you have confirmation, then how the RBC is being achieved, and what are the key components. So that's the Form 1 flow. So first challenge started where the court asked that this Form 1 has to be on, first of all, the ask was whether the customs can, on its own Suomoto, ask for Form 1, or it has to be RMS pushed request that will come to the assessing group or appraising group that will do it. So that was the first challenge that led to a lot of issues. In fact, in Bangalore port, because of these issues, the clearances got stuck because all the containers were put on Form 1 request. That's my understanding. And there were a lot of challenges. People incurred damages as well on that. Second part was the Form 1. While Form 1 was part of the rules, somewhere there was issues on whether it has to be given by importer on his letterhead or it has to be given by exporter on his letterhead. So there were varying interpretation practices, and we have heard that as well in some cases. Third was the issue of manufacturing process. So there was no clarity on to what extent you require a manufacturing process, to what extent I need to drill down on Form 1, etc. So when FAQ came out, so FAQ said that it has to be when only the customs asked through our RMS request comes, then only you have to do it. But it has happened by the time that a lot of appraising groups have also moved to ask those questions, so pile-on happened. Two, these are all manual documentation which is happening. There's no online facilitation to load a Form 1 or fill up a Form 1. So imagine a importer who is importing, say, 15 containers, and he may have per container 35-page bill of entry with 200-plus items, and he's a manufacturer. So the nightmare for the custom was to verify each of these, first a Form 1, on a manual basis and clear them as part of the requirement. And he may be an AEO, so his container cannot be held forever. Second is the issue that when the FAQ came out, so that's where the challenge was. So the trade notice was issued, and that internally by some custom houses, that only when the risk management system pushes it, then only you need to ask for, look for Form 1, etc. Two was the issue when you, on the manufacturing process, so it was also clarified that they are not asking for confidential information, just an overview. So they can understand, as Priya pointed out in the presentation, the idea is that there is a manufacturing activity happening and transformation happening between inputs and finished goods. And it shows that, yes, the exporter has the ability to convert these goods. So that was what was clarified. On the costing, etc. data, CBIC and FAQ clarified that you, if you have information, please furnish it. Otherwise, whatever you have, you can furnish it, because ultimately they are asking for key components of how RBC is formed. Now here, which something which creates a challenge is, at times when we are using non-originating material and the RBC is and we are using indirect method. So somewhere, if everything is non-originating material and the validation is still 35%, above 35%, a natural doubt comes into the mind that, is there any data management in the other aspects or the costing factors which makes this RVC? So that's where some of these issues start cropping up and doubts keep cropping up. Also, customs say that customs officers struggle to understand how, based on, because Form 1 is the only the starting point. Now, if I need to sign off and say I'm fine with what has been stated, how do I do it if the information is not complete? So the comfort is that, okay, then if either I will ask from the importer, he has to furnish that. If he is unable to furnish, or there is a challenge from an exporter side to furnish it, being either third party or related party saying there is confidentiality, etc., then it becomes a challenge for customs also to complete this process. And then the recourse is only the verification. So that these are the challenges which I would say still the struggle is on. That the only option at times, and we have seen these options, people are clearing on provisional assessment, giving 100% bank guarantee. But somewhere this needs to, somewhere I think CBIC is already seized of these challenges. Trade has represented a lot on these issues. But having said that, the compliance part is still something which is there. It needs to be handled. And the guidance has to come from CBIC. that what exactly they need, because field formation, as far as our interaction is also struggling, how to help out. We have seen cases where there are multiple queries on the assignment, on the same consignment. They ask one query, then they ask another query, then they ask third query. I've seen queries where they'll say, okay, give me computation or indirect method. Then they will ask, give me a computation or direct method. So at times, all this needs to be looked into, and maybe a resolution in some way with the objective with which Section 28D and Carotar was rolled out needs to be looked into.
I completely agree that there has to be a convergence between how the custom authorities implement and the trade also are able to do comply with it. And in fact, on the outreach, because I think that's also a very good suggestion. We will also discuss this internally. Maybe if we can pass a message to the government from FICCI side, whether, you know, outreach program from the, whether, though government would be doing it, to the custom authorities, so that like we all are on the same page. That is really important. I think we would also like to engage more with our stakeholders, because these kind of the sessions and reaching out to the importers, that is also very important. One more, sir, there is a comment rather, I won't say it's a question, there is a one comment on Carotar that Carotar will wipe out MSME importers and make customs handling even more difficult. So whether you would like to give any kind of assurance, and I mean, there's not going this, the intent is not to wipe out MSME importers. So any comment on that?
So I understand from where this question is coming. MSMEs are very, I think, are they hard pressed given the scale at which they operate. And they, yes, they form the bulk or the spine of the India manufacturing ecosystem. And if you have seen, Government of India during the pandemic has tried to take a lot of initiative to support MSMEs. In fact, AU revised guidelines have come in recently, where they have been encouraged to become authorized economic operator with lower eligibility requirements. So instead of 25 bill of entries, they only need 10 bill of entries in previous financial year. They only need to show compliances only for last 2 years. Also, they need to be only in operation for last 2 years. Their application and validation processes are more simplified with minimal documents. And they have been assured that they will given AU tier 1 or tier 2 status within 15 days or 10 days. And 60 days or 90 days. So somewhere, if I would not say that MSMEs are being singled out, it is more to do with the non-compliances with Government of India. And it is not that it has happened recently. I can share instances, and we have seen that as part of reviews, that we have seen cases where copper has come from Sri Lanka, while when the total quantum of import from Sri Lanka was checked vis-a-vis the manufacturing capability of Sri Lanka, it was found that Sri Lanka do not have that kind of capability. So somewhere Ministry of Commerce, which negotiates all these trade agreements, has to write out that they have to suspend the benefit for copper. Gold was similar case from coming from Malaysia. And also there were been cases of, I think, garlic or spices that was coming from Pakistan, though of Ghani origin. So it is not that this is a unique case. We have seen cases where circumvention has happened. Chinese goods or tiles coming through Sri Lanka with some bit of value addition. And that's where Government of India felt that while free trade agreements have been executed and there's a lot of guidance has been given, somewhere importer was simply relying on the certificate of origin and taking the benefit, while it's a duty foregone and a revenue impact for the Government of India. And importer being an availer of it in the self-assessment regime needs to be more compliant than what it has been, and they need to be aware. And in fact, when CBIC did these outreaches with Mr. Sandeep Bhatnagar and Mr. Ajit Kumar, who led this with Mr. Vimal Srivastava, etc. So they also pointed out the idea is not to discourage trade, idea is to encourage compliant trade and also to make importer or trade aware of what their obligations are. So they should not merely rely on the certificate of origin. And that's what has been stated in Section 28DA, that merely having a certificate of origin no longer will suffice.
Yes, very clearly explained. I think these are the only questions we have. There are no more questions I can see in the Q&A box regarding this Carotar and the faceless assessment. Mr. S.B. Singh, sir, so would you like to share any concluding remarks to the participants? Any message that you would like to give?
Two more questions here.
Sorry. Yeah, just a second, I'll read that.
Yeah.
It's entered in the chat box.
Yeah, I can read it. So it is saying, due to some operational constraint like document delay, if the importer cleared the goods on merit and apply for refund subsequently, will the refund paid only in custom duty plus SGST? Whether, see, IGST again is not part of the FTA. First of all, when you are talking of document delay, we need to understand what is the document delay we are talking of here. Is it that the certificate of origin was not available, or is it that you cannot fund, because 10 days is the document time that has been given currently in the Karotar. While informally, customs does allow a lot of time still for trade to answer. But as per rules, 10 days plus 15 days for them to respond. Otherwise, the verification starts. So I'm not still clear on what document you are referring to here. But if you have a retrospective certificate of origin issued, then maybe you can claim benefit if you have provisionally cleared those goods because your duty determination has not happened. And if you have met the unjust enrichment test, etc., that's also a second aspect you need to look into before you claim any exemption. Yeah, so he's saying certificate of origin. So it is a retrospective certificate of origin. So there is a likely issue that customs in Karotar may like to understand reason for this retrospective or delayed certificate of origin from the authorities. And then in this case, if you are provisionally assessed, maybe you can seek a reassessment or claim a refund. But in our experience, this may go up to a higher level before you get any relief on this.
There is some more questions in the Q&A box. That if he maintains EOO data as prescribed in Form 1, is suffice to possess sufficient information when we read Para 2 of Section 1, wherein given that this form contains a list of basic minimum information which an importer is required to possess while import. So your voice is not audible.
What I'm saying, can you repeat? I missed some part what you're saying, sure. Please.
This question is by Mr. Sarvesh Rathi. If we maintain COO data as prescribed in Form 1, is it sufficient to possess sufficient information when we read Para 2 of Section 1, wherein given that this form contains a list of basic minimum information which an importer is required to possess while import?
So I think Spriya has explained her in her session. If you are talking of certificate of origin, in any case you will be requiring. What is the pre-import section when we dealt with is that if you are going to avail certificate of origin, you have to done due diligences, and to unable to furnish a form one, you need to have that repository readily available with you. On how what is your manufacturing process? What are the originating items? What are non-originating items? How the RVC is achieved? Whether this is a general category RVC or it's a product-specific RVC, third-party invoicing. Need to be over. You mean that you are obligated starting point.
Okay, so there's another question, I think, by Navisha. How do we know at which location our bill of entry gone for assessment, and what is the timeline set for assessment?
So I'm assuming this is more to do with faceless customs. Right. See, ultimately, whenever you are filing a bill of entry, I think there is a visibility in the IceGate dashboard to know which group is dealing. That's what my understanding is, that the visibility is there to your custom broker, and they have the ID of the appraiser and the assistant commissioner, including the port code and ID, etc. So you can check and know it from when you check the status of bill of entry in the IceGate when you log into it.
Right. So there's another question by Mr. Vishal Sharma. I think the first word is missing. Cleared on the basis of COO 15 days before with duty benefit, but 2 days before, same material on same CO, same signature and stamp. Custom authorities are not clearing and saying that this signature is not matching. Please advise what to do in this case. Consignment cleared on that. Yeah.
See, one of the aspects on which at times issues happened in the past on the signature, if you're saying that your certificate of origin from the same signature, stamp, etc., normally when a certificate of origin is issued, the contracting countries exchange the signatory's name, digital signature, etc., so they can be verified, and that's the rule and the norm. And in case if there is any doubt, customs can reach out and seek a confirmation from the exporting country. So if you're saying that first consignment was cleared with the same signature, stamp, and digital stamp, and the second was is now being held up, so my suggestion would be first to understand and meet the officer. Start from the, I would say, bottom-up approach, and meet the commissioner in case if the appraiser or the assistant commissioner, deputy commissioner is unable to expedite this issue. And if it is not possible, ask them to get a confirmation from the exporting country that this is the same officer who is signed, and you can share both the documents if they show that they're the same signature of the identical person, and seek a confirmation that way.
Right. So I think these are the only questions I could see in the Q&A box. Request Mr. SB Singh, sir, would you like to share any concluding remarks before we enter session? Any message that you would like to give to the participant based on the discussions and the questions?
Not much, Ira. Mr. Rahul has already almost clarified almost everything. The only comment I will make, with reference to faceless assessment, somebody asked how he will know which port his bill of entry has gone. I don't think he need to know about that. Each port of import has a nodal officer, a nodal office. For him, any query or any, if he wants to vent out his anger against any delay, etc., will be at the port of import. If he has any problem, he can go to that nodal office. If he has any further problem, he can even meet the commissioner and chief commissioner. Now, in both these Karotar, yesterday's instruction makes it very clear that in most of the cases, it will be on the basis of RMS risk basis only. The individual officer can take up only if there's really substantial ground, and he has to show that substantial ground. Now, each chief commissioner has a very now important role to play in supervising his custom houses, knowing Sandeep Bhatnagar very closely. He has worked with me for many years. He will be keeping a close tab on all these things. So I can only assure the importing community that with just bear out for some time, the things are going to be streamlined. As far as Karotar is concerned, everybody is concerned that my MSME, somebody says that MSME will shut down all. More worried should be your exporter. They are losing their business. If they are really following the FTA rules, they will be providing you all the important information which you need. So I really feel very amazed when importers are all worried, as if the exporters are doing some great favor in exporting all these items to you. So that's the only comment I will make. And I will only request industry to support these efforts of CBIC. Because finally, they are going to make your life very easier. Thank you.
Completely agree and very well said, sir. Like, the exporter should be more worried. If India is like promoting export, encouraging, so the government tries to sort out all the issues that the exporters are facing, and things would streamline. Hoping that I mean, everything would be settled. This is just a passing phase. With this, with no questions I can see in the Q&A box, we come to the end of our masterclass. Thank you all the participants for taking out your time, and hope you all have benefited from the discussions and the detailed presentation. I think all the relevant practical aspects were covered in the presentation today. So hope you all have benefited. And in case still there are maybe some doubts, you can surely send us at our email ID. We will be, you know, going through those questions, and we'll try to give the maybe reach out to you and give the replies. Thank you, Mr. S.B. Singh, sir. Thank you, Mr. Rahul Shukla. Thank you, Sakshi. Thank you, Priha. Thank you for your time agreeing to this masterclass. And definitely, indeed, it was a very a useful session. There were perspective and the background behind the introduction of Caritor was discussed. All the examples and illustrations. So it was indeed a very useful session. And thank you once again. We'll be circulating the presentation shortly, and also the recording to all the participants who have joined us today. And do share with us your feedback, any thing you would require that maybe we should improve upon. Please share your feedback. We would be happy to receive that. With this, we just come to the end of the session, and we will also be sharing the certificate of participants participation with all the participants. Thank you once again, and take care. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thanks all.
Thank you, Ida.
Thanks.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.